All right. So this is from the accesstoinsight.org page called Right Speech, written in 2005. Right speech is Sama Vaka, Samma Vaka, Vaca. Sama is Pali for right or true or correct. Vaka is for voice or speech, the root of the Western word voice, vocalization, vocabulary even, is from vok, which is Proto-Indo-European, perhaps, or Sanskrit. Right speech is the third of the eight path factors in the Noble Eightfold Path, so it's the third, belongs to the virtue division of the path. So Noble Eightfold Path is the way, and there are three divisions. And the middle division, one is basically discipline or virtue, and another one is concentration. Let me see if I can find that again. Okay, cannot. Anyway, the definition of right speech is from a text, Samyutta Nikaya, one of the baskets in the Tripitaka. What is right speech? Abstaining or avoiding, staying away from, abstaining from lying, from divisive speech, from abusive speech, and from idle chatter. This is called right speech. Five keys to right speech. Monks, Gautama said this, I guess. Monks, a statement endowed with five factors is well spoken, not ill spoken. It is blameless and unfaulted by knowledgeable people. Now, today, with the blurring of right and wrong, or some idea that there is no right and wrong, whatever we believe is true, whatever you think is right, this kind of deception, this kind of destruction of knowledge, destruction of reason, would lead some people to think, oh, there are knowledgeable people and unknowledgeable people, there are wise people and foolish people. Oh, how judgmental. Well, if you want to develop what you are, there is a path, and there's activity that doesn't conduce to the path, or doesn't conduce to traveling and development on the path. If you want to develop what you are, you really have to develop the seven chakra system by mind, by effort, by virtue, by concentration, by insight, by development of, love, wisdom, and balance, realizing oneness. That really is true. There is, you can say the person who's done that is a wise person, and the person who hasn't is not, is immature. So, yes, the Buddha says there are knowledgeable people, and there are people who are not knowledgeable. Monks, a statement endowed with five factors is well spoken, not ill spoken. It is blameless and unfaulted by knowledgeable people. Which five? Which five factors? Here they are. It is spoken at the right time. It is spoken in truth. It is spoken affectionately. It is spoken beneficially. It is spoken with a mind of goodwill. Spoken at the right time means you don't cut people off in the middle of their sentence, except if they're, dominating or if they're being abusive. But in general, you speak at the time when it's time to speak. There's a time to be silent and there's a time to speak, and free will means do whatever the hell you want, sure. Free will means do whatever the hell you want, right? Sure, fine. However, there are rules or ways of being that are more wholesome than others for developing the factors of mind that lead to total perfect freedom and love-based awakening. And there are other factors that do not conduce to love-based awakening in reality. You can do whatever the hell you want, fine. But there really is a path. If you want to drink water, you need to take the cup with the water to your mouth and drink it. That's fine if you want to throw your cup on the wall, but that's not the way to drink water. There are other ways to drink water, but if you throw your cup on the wall, that's not perhaps the best, that isn't a way to drink water. So if you wish to achieve on the real path, which is the development of our equipment, the seven chakra system, mind, body, spirit, the purpose of incarnation is the evolution of mind, body, spirit, etc. If you want to do that, there are some activities or ways of being that conduce to doing that and others that do not. So there is a right time and there is a wrong time. There is a time when it's more beneficial for learning and growth, and a time for speaking which is not. You can cut people off if you want, no problem. But that doesn't conduce to the factors of awakening on the positive path. You know, these days people's reason, or the distinction between good and bad, or right and wrong, or positive and negative, is all being blurred and confused. So if you say he's knowledgeable, that's offensive to somebody else who may be unknowledgeable. And if you say it's spoken at the right time, and someone will say, "What's the right time?" That's subjective. Well, yeah, you could say it's subjective. However, cutting people off is not the way of love wisdom. But letting them dominate you is also not the way of love and wisdom. People can do whatever they want, but there really is a path, and there really is a way of developing our mind-body-spirit complex in love, in wisdom, on the positive path. And so the five factors, five keys to right speech, starts with it's spoken at the right time. There's no need to go yakety yak 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 all the time. It's unpleasant and it's unnecessary. You can do anything you want, but it doesn't help others and it really doesn't help the self. So it's spoken at the right time. It's spoken in truth, meaning whatever you say is true. You don't have to say everything. You can do anything you want. Fine, do anything you want. Do whatever you want. That's not necessarily the way to total development. Do whatever you want. That is not the way of either the positive or the negative path. That's the way of no path. Do whatever you want all the time. Of course, do whatever you want. Of course. But if you want development on one path or the other, there are certain activities and ways of thinking and ways of being that conduce to development on the path, positive or negative path. So if you want development on positive path or negative path, you cannot do anything all the time, whatever you want. You can, sure, but you can't do whatever you want anytime, anything, whatever you feel, and progress on the positive or negative path. So take your choice. Do whatever you want, of course. However, if you want development on positive or negative path, there are ways of being that conduce to development on the path, positive or negative. And for the positive path, speaking at the right time, which means figuring out for yourself what's the right time, and speaking in truth are key. Speaking in truth means I don't want to lie. I cannot tell a lie, said George Washington, maybe. It means know yourself well. You know, truth doesn't just mean speaking true to others, it means knowing yourself truly. Yes, I am really responsible for that. Yes, I really have those distorted patterns in mind and thought. Yes, I really am responsible for my suffering. Yes, I really am not honest. You could say, well, that's very honest. Then you are honest. But anything. Yes, I am all those things that I wish I weren't, but I am, or those are qualities of mind, streams of patterns of thought, of belief. Of reaction. That's not my identity, but yes, indeed, that's the way this mind is working. And taking responsibility is another aspect of being honest. So it's spoken in truth. It is spoken affectionately. Affectionately. With care. Affection. I don't want to hurt you. I don't want it to hurt me. I hope we can be friends. I hope we can be great friends. I hope I can be great friends with everyone in the whole world. I hope everyone in the world is my best friend. Why not? Why not? No? Of course. I hope everybody in the world is my close friend. But it's not possible. Why? Because people can't get along. Because people want some things that they're not getting. Anyway, it's spoken affectionately. It's spoken beneficially. To help. Not to hurt. To help. It's spoken with a mind of goodwill. The intention is that you benefit and I benefit. That you're well and I'm well. Always. And if it's not that way, don't talk. If it's not spoken, if you don't feel goodwill, don't speak. You can do anything you want, okay? But as far as I understand the positive path, these teachings are right or helpful. They're not the only teachings, you know? There's so many critics of everything these days. People just love fighting. At least the negative agents are spreading their poison of argumentativeness and oppositionalism. And so many people are so can't get along, you know? That's divide and conquer. But spoken with a mind of goodwill, you know it when you feel it. You know when someone's kindly. It's very natural. You know, it's the difference between what makes a child smile and what makes a child cry. Kindliness. Going further, the danger in lying. For the person who transgresses in one thing, I tell you, there is no evil deed that is not to be done. Which one thing? This, telling a deliberate lie. For the person who transgresses in one thing, I tell you, there is no evil deed that is not to be done, meaning there's no evil deed that they won't do beyond that. What one thing? Telling a deliberate lie. Telling a deliberate lie. That is the center of the negative path. Hide the real, show the false. All online covert agents hide the real, show the false. All of them tell deliberate lies. And according to Gautama, this activity, telling a deliberate lie, transgressing in one thing, therefore leads to the person being willing to do any evil deed whatsoever. And the statement is there's a stanza, a kind of verse that explains this. And the phrase is, the person who lies, who transgresses in this one thing, transcending concern for the world beyond, there's no evil he might not do. Transcending concern for the world beyond means the person who tell deliberate, the people, those who tell deliberate lies, have no concern for their future. They have no understanding of their future. They have no understanding of the karmic return. None. If they did, they wouldn't do it. But they don't, so they do it. And therefore, there's no evil he or they might not do, meaning they will do anything. Telling a deliberate lie is the center point of karmic liability, accumulating karmic liability. Telling a deliberate lie, telling a deliberate lie. How many people around are doing that? If that's what you folks are doing, you have no concern for the world beyond. Of course you don't. No problem. And when you die, you will see the world beyond, and then you will reap what you've sown. Of course. Speak only words that do no harm. One should speak only that word by which one would not torment oneself nor harm others. That word is indeed well spoken. One should speak only pleasant words, which are words which are acceptable to others. What one speaks without bringing evils to others is pleasant. So, one should speak only that word by which one would not torment oneself, nor harm others. That word is indeed well spoken, the words that don't hurt others, that don't cause suffering to others. One should speak only pleasant words. Pleasant. You can say, I think you're wrong, or I disagree, I have a different view, here's my view. Here's why I think your view is not right or wrong. I think I'm right, or I think this view is right, and your view is wrong. But that's not saying you are bad. It's just saying I think that view is wrong. Not you're wrong. You see? Really, it's I think that view, that idea is wrong. Not you are wrong. One should speak only pleasant words, and that's not lovey-dovey. Because there can be truth. This talk now is lovey-dovey? Oh, I don't think so. I don't think it's lovey-dovey. And it's pleasant enough because it's true. Words which are acceptable to others. What one speaks without bringing evils to others is pleasant. So what's pleasant is what doesn't hurt anyone. Self-purification. Oh, this is a great page. We're going to have to go on this next time. Self-purification. through well-chosen speech. And how is one made pure? In four ways, by verbal action. We get a longer description. How is one made pure? In four ways, by verbal action. There is the case where a certain person, abandoning false speech, abstains from false speech. When he has been called to a town meeting, a group meeting, a gathering of his relatives, his guild, or of the royalty, if he's asked as a witness, come and tell, good man, what you know. If he doesn't know, he says, I don't know. If he does know, he says, I know. If he hasn't seen, he says, I haven't seen. If he has seen, he says, I have seen. Simple, huh? Thus, he doesn't consciously tell a lie for his own sake, or for the sake of another, or for the sake of any reward. So they don't tell lie. He doesn't tell a lie for payment, for a salary. All the paid agents tell lies for reward. They pay. They lie for reward. That's pretty bad, actually. Thus, he doesn't consciously tell a lie, meaning deliberately. There's a big difference between being mistaken and saying something you believe is true sincerely, which is not true, which may lead to confusion, but you're not deliberately telling a lie because you consciously or you sincerely believed that was true, and there's no deliberate telling lie. So he doesn't consciously tell a lie for his own sake, or for the sake of another, or for the sake of any reward. Abandoning false speech, he abstains from false speech. He speaks the truth, holds to the truth, is firm, reliable, no deceiver of the world. Abandoning divisive speech, he abstains from divisive speech. What he has heard here, he does not tell there, to break those people apart from these people here. He doesn't make schism. He doesn't gossip to break people and break groups. What he has heard there, he does not tell here, to break these people apart from those people there. So he's not carrying gossip from this the group to that, from here to there, or there to here, to break groups. Thus reconciling those who have broken apart, or cementing those that are united. He loves concord. He delights in concord, enjoys concord, speaks things that create concord, meaning agreement and harmony in view between people or ideas. Agreement and harmony. Harmonious agreement. Agreement in harmony. He enjoys it. He delights in it. He speaks that which creates concord. Really lovely. Then, you see, there actually are four types of speech here. Four ways by verbal action. We're talking about false speech, divisive speech, abusive speech, and idle chatter. This, you know, this is the way. And this is self-purification. These are trainings. To hold to right speech is a training day by day by day. It's akin to the silence of retreat, meditation retreat in Buddhism, or many traditions, where there's no silence, no speaking, anything that's unnecessary for a period of time. Some people go into retreat for 3 years and speak nothing. That's very heavy. So the self-purification or training is through careful speech, which is to avoid four kinds of wrong speech: false speech, divisive speech, abusive speech, and idle chatter. So the third is abusive speech. So we had, again, false speech. If he doesn't know, he says, I don't know. If he knows, he says he knows. He speaks the truth, holds to the truth, is firm, reliable, and no deceiver of the world. Abandoning divisive speech, he abstains from divisive speech, and then abandoning abusive speech, he abstains from abusive speech. He speaks words that are soothing to the ear, that are affectionate, that go to the heart, that are polite, appealing, and pleasing to people at large. Nice words, kindly, has a care in speech, carefulness in their communication. No abusive speech, words that are soothing to the ear, affectionate, that go to the heart, polite, not crude, appealing and pleasing to people at large. Abandoning idle chatter, the fourth is, abandoning idle chatter, he abstains from idle chatter. He speaks in season, at the right time, or in sense of timing, speaks what is factual, what is in accordance with the goal, or self-development, transformation, the Dhamma, meaning the way, the teachings, and the Vinaya, meaning the discipline, or the way of morality. He speaks words worth treasuring, seasonable, reasonable, circumscribed, connected with the goal. This is how one is made pure in four ways by verbal action. Very lovely. And goes on, in fact, its relation to the other factors of the path, the Eightfold Path. And how is right view the forerunner? Meaning right view comes before right speech. How is right view the forerunner to right speech? One discerns wrong speech as wrong speech, and right speech as right speech. And what is wrong speech? Lying, divisive tale-bearing, abusive speech, and idle chatter. So again, there are four kinds of wrong speech. According to Gautama and the Eightfold Path, wrong, wrong, wrong. Let's not be muddy about morality. There really is a way to the development of love wisdom and a way that goes away from the development of love wisdom. Morality, or doing what is right, whatever that could be understood as, how it's truly understood, is the way of developing on the positive path love wisdom in balance. And not doing that won't develop, period. So what is wrong speech? Lying, divisive tale-bearing, meaning rumor-mongering, and gossiping. Abusive speech, anything that's you know, people shouting at each other, people cursing, any cursing. That I mean, I curse, you know, and if I was more purified, I wouldn't curse. But, you know, I don't know what more purified is, so I'm doing my best. But any abusive speech, anything that's unpleasing or harsh to the ear, and idle chatter, which people do a lot of useless talking about little things that are not important. Whatever you want is fine, but there is, on the way, there is a way, and there is a way of traveling on the way. There is a path, and there are conditions of mind, behavior, activity that lead to the ability to move on the way. And right speech is very important. Beyond that, one tries to abandon wrong speech and to enter into right speech. This is one's right effort. One is mindful to abandon wrong speech and to enter and remain in right speech. This is one's right mindfulness. Thus, these three qualities, right view, right effort, and right mindfulness, run and circle around right speech. Pretty deep, huh? So right view is the forerunner. The view is, there are paths. I'm on the positive path. Positive path is love and honesty and balance, good for all, benefit of all, service to all. On that path, there are activities that are better or worse, or helpful or not helpful. Right speech is helpful. There are these qualities or aspects of right speech that avoid wrong speech. Wrong speech could be understood as lying, being deceptive and manipulative, deliberately telling falsehood, divisive, tale-bearing speech that breaks up people and hurts people from concord. Breaks up concord, discord, talk. Abusive speech, which is hurtful or harmful or harsh or unpleasant. And idle chatter, which is garbage talk, waste of time. That's wrong speech. So by right view, one understands that. Then one tries to abandon wrong speech and enter into right speech, and that is right effort. So right view leads to right speech, by which one makes right effort. And one's mindful to continue to abandon wrong speech and to enter and remain in right speech, and that is right mindfulness, sammasati. Thus, these three qualities, right view, which comes before, and then right effort and right mindfulness to know your speech and to continue with the effort towards right speech, are the aspects or other portions of the Eightfold Path that are related to right speech. Right view, right effort, right mindfulness. And so let me read one more section, and then we'll end for today. The criteria for deciding what is worth saying. Oh ho, the criteria for deciding what is worth saying. Number one, In the case of words that the Tathagata, meaning the thus come one, Tathagata, sometimes translated as thus come one, such come one, the Buddha, Gautama, who just came, the one who just is, not some guy, he's just an expression of the one. In the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be unfactual, untrue, unbeneficial, or not connected with the goal, unendearing and disagreeable to others, he does not say them. So to know what's worth saying, the criteria for deciding what's worth saying, first is to recognize what you shouldn't say. What's unfactual, not factual, or untrue, unbeneficial, which doesn't help people. Unbeneficial means not connected to the goal. Unbeneficial means not bringing benefit, not helping people benefit themselves. Not helping people benefit themselves. If your words don't help people benefit themselves, it's wrong speech. You can do anything you want, but in a Buddhist understanding of right speech, speech should be beneficial. Connected to the goal, which really means help people, expression of love wisdom. That's all. The goal is continued development of love wisdom in truth. And that comes by manifesting that, by continuing the effort with mindfulness to continue being that, which means speak pleasantly or speak that which includes love or caring and wisdom and truth. So the Tathagata knows certain things that are unendearing and disagreeable to others also, what is hurtful, and he does not say them. Number two, in the case of words that the Tathagata, the Buddha, knows to be factual, true. Okay, oh, this is interesting. For what? That's interesting. In the case, I haven't read this before. I apologize and admit truthfully. In the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be factual, true, but unbeneficial, unendearing, and disagreeable to others, he does not say them. Very interesting. So, what is untrue and false, and not helpful and not agreeable or pleasant, but the Buddha wouldn't say. In the case of words that actually are also factual and true, but not helpful, not agreeable to others, what's disagreeable, he doesn't say that either. So, and that is a very interesting line because it indicates that from Gautama's view, straight Buddhism, from the source, before the schisms in Buddhism and the yanas, Gautama knew that which is factual and true, but not beneficial, couldn't help someone move to the goal, not endearing or was disagreeable to others, he does not say them. And that's the case of the monk who was doing the dog practice, who was living and acting like a dog, naked on the ground, crawling on all fours, eating food thrown down to the ground as their understanding of a spiritual practice. And the Buddha, his friend, asked the Gautama, "What will be the karmic destination of my friend if he successfully does his practice?" And his friend was waiting on the side like a little dog on the ground. That's really the people did all sorts of strange practices in India. Still, they do, and not only India. And Gautama didn't answer. Asked again, didn't answer. Asked again. Finally, he answered. I think on the third time he answered. The reason he didn't answer originally was because it was he, I guess, considered it unbeneficial, unendearing, and disagreeable to be heard those words that he would say. But then he did say. What he said was, "If this guy is successful, he'll be reborn in the womb of a dog. If he's unsuccessful, he'll go to hell." Meaning he'll be reborn in a hell dimension, lower astral plane. So he knew that that was true. He knew. Buddha knows. It's no dope. And he didn't say it. Why? Because he deemed it to be unbeneficial, unendearing, and disagreeable to those who were requesting to know. So there you see somebody who seems to be, finished with the path, eighth density, in the boundless, who doesn't answer a question. He knows the answer. He knows he can speak the factual and the true, But because he deemed it unbeneficial, unendearing, and disagreeable to them, he didn't say. Interesting. Number three, in the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be factual and true and beneficial, but unendearing and disagreeable, he has a sense of the proper time for saying them. Very interesting. So, if it's true and of the fact and helpful to them, or could be, but it's unendearing, meaning it's it leads to pain and disagreeable to others to hear, he has a sense of the proper time to say them. So you don't say it now, you say it later, right? So somebody has some terrible situation, it's not the right time to say, hey, bro, that's your karma, don't you know? You might want to say it later, but you surely should know the proper time. That's number three. Number four, in the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be unfactual, untrue, unbeneficial, but endearing and agreeable to others, he doesn't say them. So even if it's agreeable and, you know, he is no sycophant. He's not an ass kisser. He's not a brown noser. He knows something to be untrue, unfactual, and unbeneficial, even though it's endearing and agreeable, he doesn't say. So, you know, if somebody says, do you miss me? And you don't miss them. Well, even though it would be endearing and agreeable to say, I miss you, honey, but it's not true, then he wouldn't say. Let me just see something. So yes, if it's unfactual and untrue and unbeneficial, even though it's agreeable or endearing, he doesn't say. So he doesn't do flattery. Number five, in the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be factual and true, but unbeneficial, and yet endearing and agreeable, he still doesn't say them. So it's very interesting. If it's not true and not helpful, if it's unfactual, untrue, and unbeneficial, he doesn't say it. If it's unbeneficial and doesn't help, but still factual and true and endearing and what the person wants to hear, he still doesn't say it because it's not beneficial. So this is really subtle. And then, in the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be factual and true and beneficial and endearing and agreeable to others, he has a sense of the proper time for saying them. Why? Why is that? Because the Tathagata has sympathy for living beings. Out of love. Out of sympathy. Out of care. And so there's a gloss to this, or not, there's a couple of stanzas that encapsulate this somewhat. Samyutta Nikaya. Speak only the speech that neither torments self nor does harm to others. That speech is truly well spoken. Doesn't torment others, doesn't harm, doesn't torment oneself, doesn't harm others. Speak only endearing speech, speech that is welcomed. Speech when it brings no evil to others is pleasant. This is a lovely phrase. Speak only endearing speech, that which is welcomed. Speech which is welcomed. This is very deep. If somebody doesn't want you to speak, don't speak. Be quiet. I mean, again, do whatever you want. But this teaching says, enduring speech is equivalent to speech which is welcomed. Speech which is not welcomed is speech that's not endearing. Now, if the speech is endearing and agreeable, but not true, don't say it. So, if it is unendearing and disagreeable, bitter, but true, there is a proper time for saying it. And that's because it may be important to speak that which is true and beneficial. Factual, true, beneficial, but unendearing and disagreeable, he has a sense of the proper time for saying them. But what is unbeneficial will not be said. What is unfactual or untrue or unbeneficial also will not be said. even if it's agreeable. What is true, but unbeneficial, unendearing, disagreeable also won't be said, even though it's true, because it doesn't help them. Not only because it's unendearing. It's, the issue is not that it's disagreeable. The issue is that it's true or helpful. If it's not true, it shouldn't be said. If it's not helpful, it shouldn't be said. If it's helpful and true, even though it's not agreeable or may hurt the ear, there may be a right time to say it. He has a sense of the proper time for saying it. And so what's endearing is what's welcomed. And it may be appropriate to say what's not welcomed or not endearing and not agreeable if it's true and beneficial. But there has to be the right time. This is a training of your mouth. And so, me too. It's our training for our mouth. And you see how deep it goes, And there's a whole second half of the page here that we're going to do next time. So, that's it for the first part of this discussion of right speech, Sammavaka, from Access to Insight, one of the third of the eight path factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, belongs to the virtue division, the section of the Eightfold Path about virtue. Very, very fine, beautiful teaching. My. So, okay. Any questions? Let's just do our go around and then close it out. No, what I said was an example of when the Buddha was asked a question and didn't reply. He was asked the question by the friend of a disciple of a sect of Hinduism that believed that living like a dog was the path to liberation. So that fe his friend was naked, walking on all fours, begging for food and eating food off the dirt. And the friend asked the Buddha, "What will be the karmic? What will be the fate or the future life of my friend if he continues his practice?" And the Buddha didn't answer. Asked again, the Buddha didn't answer. Asked again, the Buddha finally answered and said, "If he's successful, he'll be reborn in the womb of a dog. If he's unsuccessful, he'll go to hell." Because he'll be so upset. So he'll either be reborn as a dog or he'll go to the lower astral in a hell dimension. Not regarding their speech, but regarding his practice. And that is an example of the Tathagata knowing something that is factual and true and actually beneficial, but unendearing and disagreeable, and initially not saying it. Because the desire, you see, there are two criteria here for deciding what's worth saying that are pertinent. Number two and number three. In the case of words that the Tathagata knows to be factual and true, but unbeneficial and unendearing and disagreeable, he wouldn't say it. So just because it's true and factual, if it doesn't help them and it's harsh and unpleasant to hear, he won't say it. However, after questioning three times, Gautama answered. And in some sense, you can say that by the persistence of the questioner, the friend of the dog, the friend of the guy doing the dog practice called dog duty, dog practice. In the case of the guy, the friend of the guy doing the dog practice, his persistence in asking three times after the Buddha refused, moved the exchange or what Buddha could say into the realm of what could be beneficial, when initially it wasn't. It's certainly unendearing and disagreeable for the guys to have heard, "Oh, my friend is going to be reborn as a dog or he'll go to hell." And actually the story is that after the monk heard that, after the guy on the ground as the dog practice heard it, he burst out crying. So be careful what practice you do. You may be reborn into hell. The persistence of asking the question, despite the Gautama refusing to answer, actually could be understood as, I don't know the Gautama's mind, but could be understood as changing the equation of assessment of what should and shouldn't be said from what's not beneficial to what would be beneficial. It's factual and true. Gautama is not lying. What he says is factual and true. But when it's not beneficial and unendearing and disagreeable, he won't say it. If it's factual and true, but also beneficial, factual and true and beneficial to help them, and yet unendearing and disagreeable, he has a sense of the proper time for saying them. So the proper time for saying was when the person, the group, those two guys, indicated by persistence their commitment to really taking the teaching to heart. And that's sometimes why a great teacher will refuse and refuse and refuse and then accept. Because the persistence of that student in that case, it's not always the same, but in that case where the teacher refuses, 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 and then accepts and says, in that case, the student's mind moved from unwillingness to hear and make use of the truth to a willingness to make use of it and help themselves and gain benefit by the demonstration of persistence. Or the demonstration of persistence was a manifestation of the person's change of mind to move towards being able to take benefit, make benefit from the speech, from the teaching. So that's the one who goes to hell, is the one who does that practice. And I sent the link there, Tripitaka Naimo. It's the Kukura Vatika, Kukura Vatika Sutta, Dog Duty Ascetic. And it's a long one, and it was very bad for that guy. But we might do that sometime. I think this is what we should stay with. It's very deep. Well, these days where, information is abundant, overabundant, the degree of information we encounter daily is much greater than ever before, even if the person's simply watching TV all day or doing their work in the office. Anything exposes us to a great, much greater quantity of information daily than ever before in human history. With that information reception, the value of comprehending right speech versus wrong speech, that speech which conduces to our path versus that speech which does not conduce to our path, the value of that understanding is more important now than ever. What goes in will come out. All the reception of information leads to a greater urge and a greater volume within of information or ideas surging towards communication without expression, speech. With that kind of situation, it's more important than ever to comprehend clearly right speech versus wrong speech. And, Gautama and every true religious teacher, spiritual teacher, metaphysical teacher, adept teacher, initiate teacher, stresses right and wrong. Right and wrong doesn't have to be judgmental or moralistic or conservative, but there is that which conduces to development and that which does not. Period. And that which conduces to harmony and good fortune and wellness and health is all associated with the positive path. So choose wisely. First of all, I don't think that the Buddha is lying, because I don't think, he just gave a whole long teaching on right speech, which is don't say what's unfactual or untrue. What you have to bear in mind is read the sutra, okay? Kukura Vatika Sutta, the dog duty ascetic. The point is that this guy was spending hours and hours and hours every day acting like a dog in all ways possible. Not thinking, crawling on the ground, taking food off the dirt, barking, scratching himself, everything. He was living as fully like a dog as possible. Now, that means that the mind is reverting to the conditions of instinct and reflex associated with a dog, with the animal kingdom. And the Buddha said, in that case, if he's successful, he'll be reborn as a dog. If he's not successful, the Buddha said, he'll go to hell. Hell means lower astral. There really are hell realms in the lower astral. That's the theory. Ra talks about Crowley and other guys going to the lower, Adolf Hitler, going to the lower astral and being in a lot of pain, needing a lot of healing. Every metaphysics talks about that, and God, Buddhism talks about hell realm too. It's not normal, true, that souls are reborn as animals. Human soul don't normally drop to second density, true. But we see in the case of Mandelker, they did, right? They are reincarnated into gorilla bodies. And in this case, which is very specialized, this guy is trying to make his mind a dog, a canine. He's trying to caninize, make his mind like a dog, totally. And the Buddha basically said, well, if you're successful, you'll be reborn as a dog, not go to moksha, liberation, enlightenment, because their teaching of the path is wrong. And if you can't do that successfully, you'll end up in huge suffering, and you'll be reborn in great rage, suffering in hell. Yes, that's right. Read the sutra, the one I just sent you there. Many people now don't want to investigate that which they have a strong opinion on and claim to understand or dislike, but they refuse investigation. If a person refuses investigation, then their opinion really has not much credibility. Now, a person may know something without investigation, but the refusal to investigate and look and read really is a sign of having wrong view or being mistaken, and doesn't really hold much water in discussion. Right. It's just the same. It's a kind of dogmatic or hard-mindedness. It's a stubborn refusal to investigate. If you don't want to investigate, it's just fine. However, don't claim to understand, and don't claim that your belief, or not you, but one shouldn't imagine one's opinion has any basis in fact. One should not imagine one is right when one refuses to investigate. It's like, I don't want to hear disagreeable truth. What I consider disagreeable, I don't want to hear. It's unendearing. And that's what the Buddha, that was one of the qualities, one of the aspects here of determining what's worth saying. Even if it's true and factual, even if it's true and factual, if it's not beneficial and not agreeable, it shouldn't be said. And even if it's true and factual and beneficial, meaning it could help, but unendearing and disagreeable, one has the sense of proper time to say it. And that may be no time if the person remains against it, for sure. Particularly, yes, anyone we have any closer relationship with and could be speaking factual and true information that could even be helpful. Factual, true, and beneficial, but still unendearing and disagreeable. It shouldn't be said. Or at least one should be careful when to say it. And so, and even if it's factual and true and endearing and agreeable and something they want to know, if it's not beneficial, the Tathagata wouldn't say, meaning it can't help. And that's very interesting. That's why a student may say, "What is my karma?" Or "What about my future?" And the future may be actually endearing and agreeable. But for some reason, the teacher can recognize that it wouldn't help them to know, even something that they might want to hear. You're going to be a millionaire in a week. Now, the teacher may perceive, a real teacher would perceive, could perceive, that the person hearing that will go out and hurt themselves, do something crazy, because they think, oh my God, I'm going to be a millionaire next week. Wow! And then they do all sorts of things and get into trouble. And that's not beneficial, so that even if it's true and factual, and endearing and agreeable. It's not beneficial, he won't say. So it must be beneficial. And it must be factual and true. That's most important. But if it's rejected, you see, if the person doesn't want it, then it's not beneficial. If the person really, really wants it, it could be beneficial. If the person can get beyond their pain at hearing it, the disagreeable and unendearing quality, it's not nice to hear, if they really want it. And that's why the Buddha really did eventually explain to the ascetic doing the dog duty what would happen. He said, the guy asked, what will be his destination? What will be his future course? And he said, enough, punna, let it be. Do not ask me that. A second time, the Buddha said, the second time that happened, and then the third time, he said, after the third time, he said, well, punna, was the friend who was asking, since I certainly cannot persuade you when I say, enough, punna, let that be, do not ask me that, I shall therefore answer you. And so, since he couldn't persuade the friend, because I guess, it shifted into the realm of those guys being able to make use of the information, he explained the karma. If his dog duty is perfected, it will lead him to the company of dogs. If it is not, it will lead him to hell. Then, when it was said, Senya, the naked dog duty ascetic, wept and shed tears. Then the Blessed One told Punna, Punna, I could not persuade you when I said, enough, Punna, let that be, do not ask me that. And so he also asked about a guy doing an ox duty practice, meaning acting like a cow. These guys did all these things then. And finally he said, if the ox duty, it will lead him to the company of oxen, meaning he'll be reborn as an animal womb. Now there are two destinations for one with wrong view. This is wrong view. And the Buddha, in both cases, the dog duty ascetic and the other guy who's an ox duty ascetic, there are two destinations for one with wrong view. I say, hell or the animal womb. So if the ox duty ascetic or the dog duty ascetic practices are perfected, it will lead them to the company of oxen womb or a dog womb. If not, it'll lead them to hell. How about that? And then the Buddha talked about forms of karma. Okay. So that completes part one of the talk on right speech. Next time we'll go to the second half of the page. And I'm not sure when we'll get to it, but we will. And thanks again. Take good care.